So let's talk a little bit about drip irrigation. Let's start with this. What is drip irrigation?
What is drip irrigation? Yeah. That's a good question. Okay. So drip irrigation could mean a lot of different things depending on what type of use you're applying it to, right? Okay. We've got a number of different tapes that could be utilized, poly tubes, micro tubing, emitters. There's all these, you know, different vocabulary to become familiar with. And they all have their place for different purposes.
Okay.
But today I want to share a drip tape layout with you all today and talk about some of the pros and cons of it. Okay. So with this drip tape system that we're utilizing, it's best used for medium to large spaces that have nice, long, continuous rows.
Right.
So if you've got bins, this isn't gonna be the one we're showing today, wouldn't really be great for like a landscape type setting,
gotcha.
Right?
Okay.
So we can do drip irrigation in landscapes, but we're gonna use a different setup, a different style than what we're talking about today.
Okay.
But for the drip tape, we've got some products here that I'll be able to show you and kind of educate you on what the pieces mean and all of the different fittings. But you can kind of see the start to our system here.
Yeah, I see.
So we've got our main line coming in from the hydrant right here.
Okay.
We've got an elbow where we turn that poly tube.
Okay.
And then we're running it all along this main heading of our planting. This is where all of our drip tapes are going to be connected. And I call this the header line. The main line comes from the hydrant to your planting area, and then this is my header line. And you could have numerous header lines. We could continue that supply line down to the planting and put in as many of those as we needed to.
Okay.
I have two in this planting, and we're just gonna look at this one today. So then once we come down our header line, you'll see where we've plugged in our drip tape connectors, essentially. And these can look a lot of different ways. So the particular ones I'm using here have valves where I can turn them on and off.
Okay.
So that's really helpful, especially if you've got some dry zones in your irrigation or certain plants that need more water than others. You can shut off everything else and leave the water, plants that need more water, you could leave those on, or vice versa. And it's also handy if you are delivering a fertilizer through these irrigation. That's called fertigation. Maybe you want to fertilize certain areas and not fertilize others.
Okay.
So that's why I included these valves. But you don't have to have these valves, and we'll look at some of those here in a minute.
Okay.
So you'll see we use those connectors to plug into this header line. We've attached the drip tape to that header line, and then these are pulled taut all the way down this planting area. So this run is about 120 feet long.
Wow.
And I like to always test out your irrigation before
I think it's smart to do that.
Yeah, before you put down this landscape fabric. So you know, landscape fabric isn't a necessity for drip tape situations, but it does provide some benefits. So I'm obviously using it primarily for weed control, but as far as irrigation goes, it helps reduce evaporation from the surface and maintain moisture in that root zone longer.
Right.
So that
which is important. Right,
yeah, so that I don't have to water as frequently.
Good deal.
So definitely these two work well together, and the tape does go under the fabric you're using them together.
Yes.
So it needs to go under the fabric.
Okay.
So we want to pull those tight. We want to test them to make sure all the plumbing is working properly, and then you can pull your fabrics over them. And another thing I really like about them, you know, some people will tack these down along that planting area, but I like to leave mine untacked so I can reach under here and pull them from side to side, right? So if I see a dry zone where my cutouts aren't getting moist, I can see a little dry zone right there. I could pull the tape over in that direction a little more and increase even wetness.
Okay. So let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Is this a one-person job?
No. Well, it could be a one-person job. It's hard when you do it alone. I would say if you can have one person or two people with you,
it would help.
Yeah, it would help. Yeah.
It's a lot of work.
It is. Yeah, it is. Okay, so let's look at some of the pieces that we can use to put this puzzle together.
All right.
So there are different size mainline tubings, the one that I, you know, showed you coming down here. So this is a 3/4 inch tubing, poly tubing. This is 1/2 inch tubing.
Okay.
And it doesn't sound like a big difference, but when you look at the diameter of those hoses, that is a big difference. So it depends on your area that you're trying to irrigate. Okay. If you have a really large space like I have here, this is 20 by 240 feet.
That's long.
So I want to make sure that we're delivering the proper volume of water.
Okay.
So I'm using a 3/4 inch poly
tube. That makes sense for that. Okay.
For a smaller home garden setting, maybe you're using this in a vegetable garden or a home cut flower garden where you've got some nice rows. maybe you want to use this half line,
right.
I mean this half inch tube right here. So just know that those are two different things available on the market. So then I want to talk a little bit about some of the fittings that go along with these. So to build your mainline tube to make your header, I know we showed you some down on the ground, you're probably going to want to employ some of these connectors. Mm-hmm. So this is an elbow,
okay.
This is a T,
elbow.
And I want to show you kind of how a couple little tricks that I use to connect these.
Oh, we like tricks.
Yes, so this one you'll see is made to fit a half inch tubing line, so that's what I'm going to use.
Okay.
Sometimes it's kind of hard to get this loosened up, so I like to take a lighter.
I wonder what the lighter was for.
Yeah, there's a wind out here, so let me. And you just kind of heat that up. Only takes a couple seconds.
Yeah.
There we go. You blocked the wind for me. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, so it only takes a couple seconds. And then we're just going to...
Look at that.
It goes on like a jewel. But if you hadn't used that, it would have been a lot more difficult.
Yeah.
So once you get it pushed onto those barbs, then this is called a Loctite nut. You tighten down this Loctite nut just like this. As tight as you can go. And then we don't get leaks.
Oh, look at that. And you got it pretty tight. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So that's how we get started.
Okay.
Anyway, when we're trying to build that main line to get out to our header line.
Got it.
Once we get to our header line, I'm going to show you how we can plug our connectors in, okay? So this is that 3/4 tube, just like I'm using here in my plot. And the barbs right here, you can tell are bigger than, say, for instance, the barbs over here. So you've got to be careful and know that you're getting the right diameter barb, okay?
Got it.
So use a commercial, I like to use this commercial hole puncher so you don't wear your hands out. You're going to go ahead and get our entrance holes started for us.
Okay.
It's pretty easy. You just slide this in the channel and punch that through, waller it out a little bit, make that hole a little bigger, and then you're ready to go.
Okay.
So I still like to use the little heat trick. Loosen that, loosen that poly tube up just a little bit to kind of help you get this barb in. Don't worry if it looks like you're getting a bend in the tube. All right.
That's in there.
So we've got that barb in there. You give it a little tug. You see it's in there nice and tight. And we are ready to continue building off of that.
Goody, goody.
So now we're going to take our drip line, our drip tape, and connect it to this connector right here. So I do want to mention that the perforations for the drip tape are in between these blue lines here on top.
Right.
Depending on what brand you get, these could be white, they could be green.
Okay.
Just know that, you know, the perforations are marked by these colored lines. And we want to make sure that the perforations are laid facing upwards when you lay your tape. If you lay them down against the soil, those little holes can get plugged by dirt. And then you're not going to get... not going to get even moisture. So we want to make sure that we lay with the perforations facing up.
Got it.
Okay?
That's good.
All right. So when we're getting ready to attach these, we want to make sure that we start with a nice clean cut.
Okay.
This end is not clean. We wouldn't want to use that end.
Clean.
Yeah. So make sure we're starting with a clean cut. And then we want to stretch this tape just a little bit to help us really get it on that barb. So I like to take my littlest finger.
So these are all the little tricks,
These are our tricks. And you just kind of tuck it in and then pull.
So you're just
stretching it just ever so slightly. Okay. Then I like to open it up a little bit.
Okay.
Ever so slightly. And then it's going to just slide right on to that barb.
And it did. All right.
But if you hadn't done that, you would have struggled and struggled.
I probably would have struggled with that.
It would have taken a while. Okay. So now we've got to tighten down this lock nut, but you've got to be careful because as you begin to tighten it, see how the tape will turn. And we don't want that because we want those holes to stay vertical, right? Stay facing up. So you gotta kind of have a finesse. I like to hold on. See, the barb is still right here. That's where the barb is.
Okay.
So I put my fingertips on the barb and hold the tape in place and then tighten the lock nut with my other hand, okay? Get it as tight as you can.
All right.
And then you're set up.
Okay.
And you just continue on, adding connectors for however many lines you need to adequately irrigate, you know, the width of whatever your row is. I'm using 3 and my rows are 4 feet wide, and I'm getting good moisture with that. And now if we pretend like we've gone all the way down to the end of the line and it's time to plug this up, right? We don't want water just spewing out the end of the line. We've got to create an end block right there. We're going to use this little end cap. It's the same concept. Stick my little finger
in. Stick your finger in there. All right.
Kind of loosen it up.
Ever so slightly.
Ever so slightly. You don't want to use heat on the poly tape. That's important. Only use, it's a vinyl tape. Don't use heat on the drip tape. Only use heat on that poly tubing.
Okay, got it.
Okay, so it slides on there real easily. Tighten that lock nut down. And I like the ones that come with this little loop because then I can put a staple in it and anchor it
to the ground.
That way the tube isn't like wiggling around too much while the water's going.
Got it.
Okay? So that is a short version on how to assemble the pieces that you would need to have a drip irrigation system at home.
That is pretty good. So let me ask you just one question, right? Where can a homeowner find all of these pieces? For
That's
the drip irrigation system?
That's a good question. Okay. So we can order online. There are some home garden kits that actually are pretty good. They're matching up the dimensions for you, so you don't have to worry if you're getting the wrong size fittings to fit the right size tubing. They're going to match that all up for you.
Okay.
And it's usually going to be based on space. How much space are you irrigating? So really any of those home garden kits are going to be adequate. Or, you know, if you get really confident and you want to have something super custom, you can certainly order it piece by piece.
Piece by piece?
And sometimes you can get a little cheaper that way. So it's good to experiment. I would suggest that whichever route you go, that you buy a few extra fittings for, you know, if something happens.
Okay.
For example, I had a drip tape that had too much pressure behind it from the faucet and it sprouted a leak. And I had to cut the leak out. And then, so this is a coupler.
Okay.
And I didn't have one that wasn't already hooked up to show y'all, but so it's got the barbed nipple on this on both sides.
Yeah, okay.
And you just slide that tape right on, tighten it down, and now you've fixed your leak.
Got it.
If it's a small leak, like maybe it's just a nick on the side. I had some voles one day that had done just a tiny bit of nibbling on the side. You can fix small tears with electrical tape.
Of course you can,
But it only works if the tape is dry. You run the irrigation, you find out there's a leak, then you have to turn off the irrigation and let the whole thing dry so you can repair it with your electrical tape. But certainly make sure you have a couple extra pieces on hand just to help you, you know, deal with those situations. Another piece of the puzzle that I failed to mention.
Okay, let's do that.
I'm gonna go, just like we had to have a plug on the end of the drip tape, we need to have a plug on the end of the header line.
Oh, okay.
So the line, well here, I'll do it on this one so everybody can see. So this is our header line. This is where you attached our drip. There's our plug for our drip.
Okay.
We need a plug for our header line. So we're gonna use a device like this, okay? And again, use our trick with heat.
It's the heat.
Heat that up just a tad bit. This fitting's gonna slide right on there.
Right on it. Yep.
Tighten down that lock nut, and you're gonna be ready to go.
So Celeste, how do we get water to our header hose?
That's a good question. Okay. We've talked about how to set up in the field. Now we need to talk about setting up at the hydrant.
So we're at the hose. What's next?
Okay, so this is what comes next. We've got options,
Options,
in this case, I wanted to start with a Y because I wanted to have a one of those Ys that leads to my irrigation, my drip line irrigation. Okay. But I also wanted to be able to have a water hose that I can fill up buckets or do other watering activities with, right? So if you feel like you're gonna need your hydrant to be serving multiple purposes, you're gonna wanna start with a Y or a splitter of some sort, okay?
Smart, I like that.
So let's start with a splitter. Okay. Then next preference is a timer. If you would like to pre-program your irrigation or your fertilizers, then you would, next in line would come your timer, okay? After the timer, what we have here is a strainer and a backflow preventer.
Okay.
And you don't necessarily need a backflow preventer if you're not using some kind of inline fertigation. Okay. So what we're doing is trying just to protect the water source. We don't want anything going backwards in the line whenever things get turned off and there's still pressure in the drip line, right? So it's naturally going to push back towards the origin.
Okay.
So we've got a strainer and a backflow preventer. The next thing in line is a pressure regulator. So you may or may not need a pressure regulator, but I'm gonna say in most cases you will. This hydrant has very strong water pressure because it's ran off of a city water source.
Oh, okay.
So city waters, county waters oftentimes have pretty high pressure. Well waters tend to have less pressure attached to their sources.
Okay,
so you may need that so that you don't blow out your drip tapes,
okay?
And depending on what thickness drip tape you get, it's gonna have a pressure rating and it's gonna say you can't go over 30 PSI, you can't go over 50 PSI.
Oh, that's good to,
right.
good to know.
And
yeah.
so that's
okay.
gonna help you know what type of pressure regulator to put in there. And then you attach your main line. And if you're not doing any kind of fertilizing, that's all you have to do. This line would go directly, you know, you plumb it out to wherever your planting area is, you start attaching your drip tape. In my situation, I'm connected up to a commercial, well, an industrial type fertilizer injector.
Okay.
And I put my soluble fertilizer in this bucket and this suction hose takes it up and this meters it into my mainline hose, which comes out on your side. For home gardeners, they may find this is going to be more the size of what a home gardener might have. If you're wanting to do some kind of inline fertigation, they mix the water soluble in here, they attach it to their line. Wherever you purchase this, it's going to have a connector kit that comes with it. So don't worry about not having the right size connectors because it's going to come with that kit to connect it to your mainline hose.
Okay. So let's define something real quick for the homeowners. Water soluble.
Water
what do we
soluble.
Mean by that?
That is the fertilizer that you can mix in water and it dissolves.
Okay.
And then you deliver that fertilizer to the plants via the water.
Got it.
Does that make sense?
That's good.
So it looks like we have a lot of things going on here, but the important thing is to remember the general order. Okay. So we've got water source, timer, backflow and strainer, pressure regulator, main line. Okay.
I think that's good.
All right.
Thank you, Celeste. We appreciate that.
I've had fun talking about drip.
This has been fun. I appreciate it so much.
All right. Let's do it again.
All right.